Okay.
Wow.
We are live on YouTube. Okay. All right. Well, is it me in your computer, John? All right. It's 10 o'clock in Iowa. 6 o'clock in Moscow, probably 5 p.m. in Western Europe. Must be 5 p.m. where Wojciech is.
Yes,
so
exactly.
Please welcome our guest, the lecturer, Wojciech Gurgul, who is going to tell us interesting things about the connection, the sources that document the origin of the Russian guitar in Poland. Thank you, Wojciech.
Okay. So good morning or good afternoon. Like Oleg said, my name is Wojciech Gurgul and I am a PhD student at the Jan Długosz University in Częstochowa in Poland. Today's lecture will be devoted to the Polish sources related to OpenG tuning. Maybe just a quick reminder, what does OpenG tuning mean for those who are maybe not familiar with this term, maybe for listeners from Poland. An open G tuning allows a G major chord to be strummed on all strings with neither fretting of the left hand nor a capo. For example, in Spanish guitar it can be D, G, D, G, B, D. And in the Russian guitar we have repetitive open G tuning D, G, B, D, G, B, D. Okay. In Poland we can find two groups of sources that refer to open G tuning. The first group is related to editions and manuscripts for English guitar created in first two decades of the 19th century. The second one is related to publication for seven string guitar from first four decades of the 20th century. So let's begin with the overview of the first group. English guitar, which is a kind of cithern, was a common and very popular instrument in the second half of 18th century in Western Europe, mainly on the British Isles. A typical English guitar had 10 strings arranged in six courses. The two lowest strings were single strings. The tuning was based on the C major chord, sometimes on the A major and G major chords. This last type of tuning was commonly used in Poland, where English guitar, in Poland named Gitara angielska, gitarra, or gitarra, was very popular at the turn of 18th and 19th centuries, mainly at the beginning of 19th century. I'm going to present a few quotations from 19th century and early 20th century books on studies on cultural life in Poland. For the purpose of this lecture, I have translated all quotations from Polish into English. Translation from old Polish language was quite a challenge, so please be very understanding. The most famous quote connected to the English guitar can be found in Alexander Fredro's comedy Zemsta, The Revenge, from 1833. However, maybe instead of a quote, I will present a short part from the film adaptation of this play. By the way, in this movie, the role of Papkin, the guitarist, is played by the director Roman Polański, but the film was directed by Andrzej Wajda. Unfortunately, the instrument used in this scene is not English guitar, but the five-course Hamburger Waldzither belonging to Professor Marcin Zaleski from Chopin University of Music in Warsaw. So I am going to open the video.
Córuś moja, dziecię moje, co u ciebie szepcze? Pani matko, dobrodziejko, kotek mleko chłepcze. Oj kot, pani matko, kot, kot, narobił mi w pokoiku łoskot. Córuś moja, dziecię moje, co u ciebie sztuka? Pani matko, dobrodziejko, kotek myszki szuka. Oj kot, pani matko, kot, kot, narobił mi w pokoiku łoskot. Córuś moja, dziecię moje, czy ma ten kot nogi? Pani matko, dobrodziejko i srebrne ostrogi. Oj kot, pani matko, kot, kot, narobił mi w pokoiku łoskot.
When in Poland somebody hear gitara angielska, he always think Zemsta and Fredro and Papkin playing this song. Okay, so now we will back to quotations. Warsaw historian Marceli Hendelsman wrote in 1911 in his book entitled Warsaw in the Years 1806-1807, I quote, an English wire-strung guitar was the most common instrument and it was present in almost every educated house, end of quote. We can find another quotation in the book published in 1880 entitled Warsaw, Her Mental Life and Literary Movement During 30 Years from 1800 to 1830 by writer and historian Kazimierz Władysław Wójcicki. I quote, after 1808, Spanish guitars slowly begin to appear in larger size than English and with different strings. But this type of guitar was typically only for men. Women have always remained with it all light and easier to play, end of quote. This opposition of the male Spanish guitar in the female English guitar has been very often described in sources, like in magazine Quosy from 1878. I quote, to the singing of numerous songs, a cheap musical instrument was served, which was an English wire-strung guitar widespread in this period from 1794 to 1830. At the same time, Spanish guitar became increasingly popular instrument that our soldiers from Spain brought. English guitars served women rather than men. In the attached picture, this picture on the slide, the artist present a young woman with an English guitar, end of quote. But to be precise, there are also sources confirming that men also played the English guitar. For example, in second volume of Memories of Historian, Antiquarian and Archaeologist Ambroży Grabowski from 1909, we can read, I quote, Mr. Nowosiński taught me on the English guitar. It was an instrument quite common, but nowadays totally abandoned, end of quote. English guitar was popular not only in Warsaw. Mentioned Ariel Wójcicki in book Warsaw and its community at the beginning of our century from 1878 described, I quote, the English guitar was once so widespread that in the courts of the Mazovian nobility, the ladies accompanied themselves to sing. The Spanish guitar hasn't been in possession of women because it is an instrument exclusively attached to men, end of quote. In book Galiciana, 1778-1812, devoted to southern Poland from Lviv to Krakow, written by historian, journalist and lawyer Stanisław Sznur-Pepłowski and published in Lviv in 1896, we can find a small citation from Austrian book Versich über die slawischen Bewohner der österreichischen Monarchie by Lviv's professor Josef Rehr. I quote, the most common instrument was the English guitar, end of quote. Other source, ethnographer and librarian Łukasz Gołębiowski in 1831 in book Games and Activities of Various Social Layers Throughout the Country or Some Provinces Only wrote, I quote, Spanish guitar is a very quiet instrument with low tones. It's usually used to accompany a song with pitched chords. English guitar is used to play the easiest pieces. In Grand Duchy of Lithuania, both guitars play together. One of them plays the first voice, second, the bass and second voice. This makes the accompaniment fuller. End of quote. We don't have information about the popularity of the English guitar only from the Western Poland, Wielkopolska, Greater Poland around Poznań, and the Górny Śląsk, Upper Silesia, around Katowice. Although in recent days I come across a new manuscript, which I found very interesting. It probably comes from the area of Greater Poland, Wielkopolska. However, it requires further research, so I'm not going to describe it today. Okay, so let's jump into the description of the instruments. Single instruments have survived to our times, including the guitars shown in the presentation. On the left, you can see the guitar of the Józef Kwiatkowski from Warsaw from 1813, now in possession of Germanisches Nationalmuseum in Nuremberg. On the right, the guitar of Antoni Weinert, also from Warsaw, from 1806, now in Music Instrumente der Universität de Leipzig. They are also the instrument made by Tomasz Pasamoński from Krakow, built in 1822, now in possession of National Museum in Krakow. Instrument by Marcin Balczewski from Vilnius, built in 1786, now in Adam Mickiewicz Museum of Literature in Warsaw. An instrument by Szymon Gutowski from Krakow, built in 1811, now in Museum of Musical Instruments in Poznań. In the literature, we can also find information about guitars by Wojciech Pilichowski, Ignacy Chruścicki, Franciszek Janiszyński, Franciszek Markiewicz, or Henryk Mittendorf. Now we'll back to sources. There are three groups of sources connected with English guitar in Poland. Original composition, arrangements and editions by Józef Elsner, set of manuscripts from Jagiellonian Library in Krakow, and two manuscripts from Diocesan Library in Sandomierz. I will describe now first group. So, Józef Elsner was a Polish composer, editor and teacher with German origins. For example, Chopin was among his students. He was one of the most important musical personality in 19th century Poland. He initiated the 19th century Warsaw music publishing movement. One of his first publications released in 1803 was Pięć arii z opery Przerwana ofiara z muzyką pana Winter przekładana gitarą angielską, which means five arias from the opera Das Interbrechene Opferfest by Peter von Winter for English guitar with lyrics. One of these aria you can see on the slide. His most important and successful publishing project was Wybór pięknych dzieł muzycznych i pieśni polskich. In English, a selection of beautiful musical works and Polish songs, which was a collection of pieces for piano and songs with accompaniment published every month during years 1803 to 1805. Due to enormous popularity of English and Spanish guitar, he decided in 1805 to add a supplement for Spanish or English guitar. Four numbers with an addition for an English guitar have been released. Apart from the arrangements of experts from operas by Elsner, by Luigi Cherubini and by Antonia Salieri for English guitar with lyrics, a selection of beautiful musical works and Polish songs includes the first, probably original, anonymous composition for solo English guitar in Poland. You can see this piece on slide. And I'm going now to play a recording of this piece. I want to, sorry for being out of tune. I have only an old Russian guitar made before Second World War in Czechoslovakia. It looks like this, and I'm the Spanish guitarist, so the Russian guitar is a new experience for me. Most all of these pieces published by Elsner are in G major, sometimes in C major, like this piece. And all of them are for English guitar tuned in G major. As a curiosity, I will add that Elsner also used both guitars, Spanish and English, in his opera Leszek Biały, czyli Czarownica z Łysej Góry, which means Leszek the White and the Witch from the Bald Mountain. Interestingly, he had the English guitar tuned in F major, but the part is written in G major. As far as I know, this is probably the only use of the English guitar in stage composition. You have the part for English guitar, angielska gitarra. Okay. And the second group of sources. All manuscripts connected with second group of sources are gathered in one set, bound together in possession of Jagiellonian Library. This collection, created probably around 1804-1808, contains 10 manuscripts for English guitar tuned in G major, solo and with text, with lyrics. The collection includes arrangements of experts from operas by Józef Elsner, Peter von Winter, Luigi Cherubini, Etienne Meil, Armand Seville, as well as little arrangement of Polish song Sen Miałem, I Had a Dream, two sets of small solo pieces, mainly dances and short classical pieces like Andantino or Allegretto, and two the most interesting sources. The only non-anonymous original piece for English guitar solo in Polish sources, sixth variation by C. Carla Motti, with Polonaise as a sixth variation. In addition to that, we can find there a method, textbook with 16 lessons. The very important for us is the lesson number 5, where we can learn about the tuning of the English guitar, the G major tuning. Here is this lesson, Piąta Lekcja, Strój. The 5th lesson, tuning. Almost all compositions are in G major, some of them in C major, and one arrangement has a long part in G minor. Now I'm going to play the recording of Kozaczok in G major and a set of variation on French song Au clair de la lune, in the moonlight, by Carla Motti, also composition by Elsner in C major.
Oleg, mute your mic. Oleg.
Oops.
Thank you. By Carla Motti. To be honest, playing the C major chord on my guitar is quite impossible for me. I have too fat fingers for this fretboard. So sorry for all mistakes. Okay. Last manuscripts can be found in the Diocesan Library in Sandomierz. The first source contains 18 small dances, the second one, 29 dances and classical pieces, rondos and sets of variations. Those two sources are connected with the female Benedictine Sisters School in Sandomierz and a music teacher, Franciszka Kozłowska. Those manuscripts were written around 1811, 1812. Almost all pieces are in G major. Only two compositions are in C major. One of them with long part with C minor. The most interesting issue is the fact that almost all of those pieces are written for a seven string or seven chords English guitar with low D. Perhaps individual instruments of this type have survived to our times, but I am in the process of museum research, which is quite difficult due to COVID situation. At the moment, I only have old drawings and photos such as those posted on the slide. This seven string or seven chords guitar may be the instrument that Gustav Hesse de Calve or Vladimir Ivanovich Dahl calls the Polish guitar. Okay, and let's listen now one of composition from these manuscripts. It will be a rondo with long part in C minor. And on the slide you can see those seven string instruments from probably Polish museums.
Thank you.
In the second part of this, one a bit more. The English guitar has been present in Poland at least since 1760s, when Józef Borówłaski, a dwarf famous at the European courts, who played the English guitar. Here is the small English guitar on this image. Returned to Poland after traveling around Europe. The last mentions of English guitar concerts in Poland came from 1829. The Spanish guitar most likely appeared in Poland after partitions in 1719, first in a five-string version. For example, Elsner published his works for a five-string guitar. And after the Napoleonic Wars, a six-string type appeared. The first publication for a six-string guitar is by Valenty Kratzer and came from 1818. The last publication for a Spanish guitar came from 1834, and it was in use until the 1860s. So as you can see, for at least 30 years, both guitars have functioned side by side. The last Polish guitar virtuoso, Marek Kondrat Sokołowski, died in 1884. The last decades of the 19th century were a time when the guitar practically did not exist in the Polish music community. It was not until the first decades of the 20th century that sources dedicated to guitar appeared. What is more is interesting, the first publications were dedicated to the Russian guitar. And in the second part of this presentation, I would like to focus on Polish sources for Russian guitar. From the first half of the 20th century. In the end of 18th century, Polish English guitar probably had come from Poland and Bohemia to Russia. And at the turn of the 19th and 20th century, Russian guitar came from Russia to Polish territories. But the name Russian guitar was not used in Poland before the Second World War. All editions were titled for a seven-string guitar. All publications and musicians were connected with Congress Poland under the Russian domination, green and light green on the map, this big part. There is no publications for seven-string guitar in Kraków or Lviv, in Austro-Hungarian Empire, orange on the map, or in Poznań or Katowice, in Prussia, pink on the map. Of course, after 1918, Poland was independent country, but these differences between those three parts were still strong. There are only two original compositions for seven-string guitar published separately in Poland. They were both composed by G. A. Archipow and published in 1906 in Łódź. These were first publications written for seven-string guitar in Poland. Those two pieces were Wospomnienie o Mandżurii, Wals dla siemistrunnej gitary, and Żursanie Rucia, Upraźnienia thrillerami dla siemistrunnej gitary. Unfortunately, both are lost now. Archipow wrote a short article entitled About the Guitar and its Connoisseurs and Small Guitar Waltz Skazka, a Fairy Tale. This on the slide. Both were published in journal Accord in the years 1913-1914. In the same magazine, we can find an article about street musician by Valerian Rusanov, which is dedicated to Archipow. So maybe Archipow was a street musician and lived for a few years in Łódź in Congress, Poland. I don't know it. Maybe some of you have more information about Archipow. It would be great if somebody know something more about Archipow. The two main musicians who are connected with seven-string guitar in Poland were Hersch Pomeranz and Zofia Zdziennicka. Hersch Pomeranz was a Warsaw teacher who published a lot of duo arrangements for guitar with voice, with mandolin or with violin, and for mandolin ensembles. He arranged, for example, Moskva by Johann Decker Schenk for mandolin quartet with parts for six and seven string guitar. You can see the part of seven string guitar on the slide. He also published six volumes of anthologies of solo guitar pieces named zbiór utworów klasycznych i salonowych na gitarę siedmiostrunową, strój rosyjski, collection of classical and salon pieces for seven string guitar, Russian tuning, now unfortunately lost. He was an only author who had used name Russian tuning in his music publications. His most important publication was Nowa Praktyczna i Teoretyczna Szkoła Gry na Gitarze Siedmiostrunowej, część pierwsza, which means A New Practical and Theoretical School for Seven String Guitar, Part 1, published in 1931 in Polish and Russian languages. This method provides guitar techniques, contains a lot of original exercises and studies in various keys. For example, in major keys C, G, D, A, E, F, and minor keys A, E, B, D, G, C. Arrangements of popular pieces and other concert pieces probably were planned for the second part of the method, mentioned at the end of the first part, now lost or never published. All his publications were released in Warsaw by probably his own publishing house, Melodies Internationales. His method, here we have the cover of this method, was last known Polish method for seven string guitar. In the preface to his book, he criticized all methods previously published in Poland. You can see example of one of study from his method on the slide at Juda study. Sorry. One of the criticized methods is by Zofia Zdzinnicka-Bergerowa, publishing only under her maiden name, Zofia Zdzinnicka. She was the most important person in pre-war Poland connected with guitar and other plucked instruments. She studied in Warsaw Institute of Music and in Vienna Academy. She published the method and a lot of arrangements for mandolin, arrangements for zither, also methods for and anthologies of concert pieces for six and seven string guitar and romantic lute. For seven string guitar, she published two methods and one anthology of arrangements. This criticized method was Szkoła na gitarę siedmiostrunową według systemu nutowego i cyfrowego, which means method for seven string guitar with notes and tablature, published in Warsaw circa 1920. Zdzinnicka's goal was to bring plucked string music to an appropriate rank in musical life. Besides more professional publications, she decided to publish a method for amateurs containing tablature. For Pomeranz, this way of teaching was unacceptable. One piece from this publication, Polish National Anthem, is shown on the slide. Her first method for seven string guitar, and according to the introduction, the first one published in Poland was Szkoła na gitarę siedmiostrunową, method for seven string guitar, published in Warsaw circa 1912. This method had a fewer editions, one circa 1925 and one after 1928. Publication contains, at the beginning, general information about music and guitar, then exercises arranged by position following the pattern of violin schools, not by keys like in Pomeranz method. At the end, she included a few transcriptions, for example, works by Moritz Moszkowski, Georges Bizet, Stanisław Moniuszko, Giacomo Puccini, or Frédéric Chopin. This method, like also her third publication, Album na gitarę siedmiostrunową, Album for Seven String Guitar, published in Warsaw circa 1930, was an adaptation of her six-string publication. So they are not too idiomatic for seven-string guitar. For example, she included a few compositions by Carulli and made only small changes to them. Other example of such proceeding is arrangement of Moniuszko songs Prząśniczka, The Spinner, in which she changed only one chord, like you can see on the slide. This is the version from seven string guitar, and this is the version for six string guitar. In her publications, she used mainly keys typical for Spanish guitar, C, D, E, G, A major, C, D, E, G, A, B minor. There were also two publications named Samouczek, self-study book. First by L. Solski, author of currently lost Samouczek na gitarę siedmiostrunową opus 88, tutorial for seven string guitar opus 88, published circa 1913. And the second one by Wincenty Janiszewski, named Samouczek na siedmiostrunową gitarę. Zawiera popularne melodie oraz przygotował je do zespołów, which means tutorial for seven string guitar includes popular melodies and prepares for ensembles. Published in Warsaw circa 1930. Janiszewski was a composer, conductor of military bands and music teacher in Warsaw schools. All his publications, for example, Methods for Mandolin or Trumpet, were dedicated to amateur ensemble. In his guitar method, there is one interesting sentence which show us the position of seven string guitar in pre-war Poland. I quote, "The most popular in Poland, next to the six string guitar, is the seven string guitar, used by amateurs who played mostly by ear," end of quote. He used a small number of keys, C, D, G, major, C, D, G, A minor, and not all of his arrangements were suitable for seven string guitar. For example, here is the arrangement theoretically for three seven string guitars. But a few arrangements are more ambitious, like this on the slide, Gypsy Waltz. And the last author I would like to present was Roland Erdelyi, connected with Nowogródek, now in Belarus, who published in Warsaw two methods for seven string guitar with modified tuning, D, G, C, D, G, B, D. Those books were Przystępna szkoła na gitarę siedmiostrunową, which means an affordable method for seven string guitar, published in 1928. And the second one, now lost, Szkoła akordów na gitarę siedmiostrunową, which means method for accords for seven string guitar. Both editions were dedicated to amateurs who want to play simple accompaniment songs. He used an original way to chord notation, containing special signs denoting different ways of using the right hand. Bass and three notes, arpeggio, or full chord. His arrangements were in variety of keys, C, D, G, A, B major, and C, D, E, F, F sharp, A minor. That is all music publications related to seven string guitar from Poland. In literature from this period, there is also one article from 1933 by Felix Sachse in magazine Zespół Mandolinowy, Mandolin Ensemble, named six or seven string guitar with the question mark at the end, where this Silesian musician connected with mandolin orchestras considers the pros and cons of both guitars in the context of the development of the guitar and mandolin ensembles community in Poland. By the way, in all his publications, he used six string guitar. In this article, he noticed a few things. Apart from normal Russian tuning, tuning DGC, DGBD is also sometimes used in Poland, like in Erdelyi's publication. The thumb of the left hand is used only in seven string guitar. Six string guitar playing doesn't require it. Russian tuning is simpler than Spanish tuning, and Russian tuning is also less artistic. There are more foreign publications for six string guitar than for seven string. And the conclusion of the article is that it's better to develop in Poland six than seven string guitar. These truths in the guitarist community and a fact that after the Second World War, Russia politically occupied Poland, which aroused aversion to everything that was Russian, caused that seven string guitar disappeared from Poland after the Second World War. And after Second World War, only a few old Polish musicians used to play seven string guitar. For example, Donat Serda Polski, who lived after war in Wrocław, and before war he studied in Moscow. Currently, to my knowledge, nobody in Poland plays the Russian guitar. The seven-string guitar appears only as a variant of the Spanish guitar, for example, in the experiments of the luthier Piotr Alexander Nowak from Krakow, who adds an additional bass string, B. Okay, that's all sources for Russian guitar and English guitar. Thank you for listening to my presentation. I don't hear you, Oleg.
Wojciech, thank you so much for your presentation. That's incredibly interesting, you know, for people who got together here. I would like to ask if anybody has questions. Stefan, John, Evgeny. You can type. Если есть вопросы, Евгений, можете напечатать в чате.
I'll try to answer.
Yeah. Well, while people are thinking, I can talk about. I mean,
some questions later. I can give my email and I can answer.
Yeah. Well, I mean, maybe people will. I mean, we basically need to proceed to masterclass. But I mean, while we have the attention on this topic. I mean, basically, what I find absolutely fascinating is the fact that, as we talked privately, the third partition of Poland in 1795 had phenomenal influence on the development of the Russian guitar in Russia, because a lot of Polish people, or people not Polish but from Poland, such as Ignaz von Hell, or Andrei Sichrak, who wasn't from Poland, but he was from Rzecz Pospolita, from Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. He was born in Vilnius, in Lithuania, and etc. So those people ended up in Moscow, and that sort of gave the boost of the Russian guitar, this tuning kind of arrived from Poland. And it's interesting that with the second part of your presentation, and then there is a certain movement back, for the later part, it looks like for the 20th century sources, whatever happens is somehow under the influence of the Russian guitar tradition that once was influential. And, I'm sure a lot of Russians lived in Poland and had students, etc.
The third partition was also very important for develop of Spanish guitar in Poland. After third partition, a lot of German musicians came to Poland. The German part of partition at the beginning was very, very big.
For those who don't really know by heart Polish history or Russian history, I just would like to make a footnote that until 1795, there was a rather powerful political entity for several centuries called the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth that eventually, the jealous neighbors couldn't just take it anymore. And in 1795, it was divided, if I'm not mistaken, by Russian Empire, Austro-Hungarian Empire, and Russia, right?
Exactly. But the at the beginning, the part which was named Królestwo Polskie, the Polish kingdom, was part of Prussia, not Russia. After Napoleonic Wars, this part of Poland goes to the Russia. So at the beginning, all these areas were under the German domination, and German musician with six-string guitar came to Poland and started.
Which is also interesting, because to Russia, Germans to some extent brought the seven-string guitar, like it's Johann Hans. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in Europe, it's very kind of fascinating how the same idea travels from one country to another. And the Germans who were introducing seven-string guitar in Russia, they were talking about it as a French innovation, French instrument. So it's nice with Europe and things exchange and all that. But of course, when it's about Russia and Poland, it takes much more brutal sort of terms, because it's about domination, about colonization, you know. And I perfectly understand that, you know, in the 20th century, you know, the seven string guitar, with all of its nice tuning, you know, it's more the instrument of the oppressor than the instrument that goes back to Polish history and reminds people what it used to be at the time of Elsner and and those manuscripts that you showed. John, do you have something to ask?
No, but I think Stefan does.
Go, Stefan.
Okay, I was just asking about, thinking about this Hanf, because he used this tuning with a raised fifth string, or you say sixth.
Right.
That has a C instead of a B.
Right.
And that comes from Hanf, right?
Right. But he talks about it as a improved French guitar.
Yeah.
So that's the branch of influence that is not directly related to Poland.
Okay.
You know, that's sort of Western, so to speak. And that's already after the moment that the Polish influence was fully absorbed. Wojciech, what kind of interests me, if you could open a slide where with some piece, like the first piece that you played.
Okay. For example,
this one. Yeah, I mean, basically, what's interesting and what would be very interesting to find, you know, like, for example, the instrument as a physical body, it has also some kind of, you know, some ethereal kind of extension, right? It has some habits attached to it, some kind of playing technique, some social associations. So, for example, when the English guitar was adopted in Poland, it also got the association that it's a simple music to be played by women. This whole package, not just the instrument, but this whole. And so, basically, what I see in terms of, you know, the quality of music, I see that the instrument and the tuning, you know, they definitely came to Russia and they definitely made the difference there. But I don't see any traces of like preferred articulation. Like, for example, this thing. Do I have original sound on? Okay. So, like, there is no Russian source that says this.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't exist. Okay, that's maybe not the best example. Can you find another piece?
Okay.
Kramot
or Bessner?
Yeah. That one. So yeah. I'm just trying ad hoc to put Russian fingering idea. I don't know if it can be seen.
But this idea wasn't easy, yeah? It should be easy for women who played it by...
No, but I mean, basically the question is there evidence for fingerings such as...
No, there is no fingering anywhere. Maybe in this new manuscript from Wielkopolska, which I sent you last week.
Right. But I mean,
but this manuscript is in German, so I have to translate it.
Well, I haven't digested all the, you know, materials that you sent to me because I was busy preparing the pestle. But I mean, basically what's interesting, if in the method you can find something about it, but because from this music it appears that every note is articulated in the right hand.
There was one slur between D sharp and E. And that was the first thing I noticed, that the lack of slurs going on.
Yeah.
And I think some of that may have to do, you know, on a small English guitar with the metal strings, slurring doesn't work as well as it does on gut strings on a larger instrument. So that may be part of it. And I would think if they were doing scales across strings, there would be fingerings marked in it. And maybe some of the sources where they use tablature, that would be indicated as well. But it seems to be completely devoid of that.
Yeah, I mean, it. You know, English guitar in English sources often appears as a melodic instrument, as like similar textures are similar to violin. You know, it's not necessarily, you know, an instrument that plays both chordal accompaniment and melody at the same time. So very often it's just the upper line, sometimes in thirds. Mm-hmm. Oh, look at that. We have our student. Okay, Wojciech, I mean, I can talk about it really forever, and because it's of great interest. I want to tell everybody that that basically when I was writing my dissertation 25 years ago, I just couldn't dream that a person like Wojciech Gurgul would appear and contact me, because I just wanted to find this missing link in the evolution, you know, the Polish music from earlier times for the instrument guitar, English guitar. And I knew it existed, and I even knew the reference in Fredro, Alexander Fredro, you know, that the movie with Roman Polanski was made up. But nobody was studying it, Wojciech. And the thing is that, you know, there is certain openness, academic openness, that is typical for, you know, American academia, and maybe is not particularly typical for Europe, Central Europe, you know, former Soviet bloc. I'm pretty sure that there is still, you know, a lot of cult of masterpieces, and like studying guitar would be hard. Guitar scholarship is hard, and then on top of that, guitar scholarship of very simple pieces. So I wish you luck in your dissertation, and your research will always remain of great importance and interest for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you also for inviting me.
Okay, you can stop sharing now. And now our attention goes to Tatiana Bestigolnikova. Добрый вечер, Таня.
Здравствуйте.
Что вы будете играть? What are you going to play? So the waltz called Mirages by Pavlo Fazantcheyev. Very good. So let's see how we hear it. Thank you. Wow. I think it's much better than in the concert. I mean, there is something live that just really... Stefan, since we published this music, you know, find your edition and maybe you will have some questions. I mean, this performance at such high level that for us, it's hard to find useful things to say. So, Таня, вы понимаете более-менее? Дифирамбы. Хорошо. Okay, John.
Oh, well, very, very nicely played, and a you know, a difficult piece with many, many details in it, and very impressive, you know, that you've memorized not only the notes, but you seem to have incorporated many of the suggestions that the composer makes, and he doesn't really leave much open to chance. There's so much indicated in terms of dynamics and speeding up and slowing down and tempi. And some of it is a little bit counterintuitive the way it's written. I'd like to just sort of look at a section at a time, starting with the introduction. The first thing I noticed about the introduction, and I noticed this in your in the video of you playing it as well, is that you seem to put the fermata on, you know, the downbeat of the fourth measure, and then again you do it on the downbeat of the eighth measure. I think if I were playing this piece, I would probably play, you know, it's slower and it's a little bit more open than when you get to the actual waltz tempo, but I think I would play that fourth measure in time and save the fermata for the downbeat of the fifth measure. So you're basically playing the gesture in time and then pausing and then taking off again, playing the gesture in time and then pausing at the fermata. I feel like you added two additional fermatas. So I would love to hear the introduction where you play the fourth measure and the eighth measure in time and just do the fermata on the downbeat of the subsequent measure.
Татьяна, вы поняли? Что? Не все поняли, да? Ну, он просто говорит, что стратегически, может быть, имеет смысл не играть фермату в четвертом такте и где еще? Sorry, John, I kind of forgot.
I was just saying, in measure four, she pauses before she plays the eighth notes on the second and third right. beats. And it kind of, she puts a fermata there, and then in measure eight, the same. And I think I would do those in time and save the pause for the next measure.
Which is what, measure nine?
Yeah, measure five and then measure nine, where the fermatas are actually written.
Okay.
She's giving it a, you know, considerably more freedom prior to that, and I think I would play those gestures in time.
Okay, so я сам не уверен, что в точности понял, что Джон предлагает, но сыграйте только интродукцию и не делайте фермата, просто играйте ровно и только. И только в какой-то момент сделайте фермата, но этот момент я еще сам не понял. Так что просто сыграйте сначала без фермата, грубо говоря.
So I think she needs to avoid rolling the chord so broadly on the downbeat of the fourth measure.
И не раскладывайте так широко аккорд на первую долю четвертого так.
Yeah. Yes, I thought the second one was more successful and more along the lines of what I'm looking for. And then, of course, the next four eighth notes, you're leading into the new tempo, the tempo of the waltz. And that next section, which is measure 10 through measure 28, all with the harmonics, no comment about that at all. I thought that was just very, very well played.
Следующая секция идеально с этими с флажолетами. Я от себя добавлю, что такое впечатление, что ему сама гитара подсказала мелодию, потому что, ну, как бы трудно написать мелодию целиком, состоящую из натуральных флажолетов, но ему удалось. I'm just saying that just the guitar itself kind of suggested the melody, because it's hard to write a melody consisting only of natural harmonics, even on a Russian guitar. So that's how he composed it.
So in the next section, 29 through 36, so many directions from the composer. I think what I want to hear from the piece in general, and I was getting some, more of that hearing you play it live than I did from the video, was I think the whole thing could be a little bit wackier, a little bit crazier, and a little bit less serious. And I think in order to do that, there needs to be more extremes in some of the gestures. And one of the things that I found interesting that the composer does, for instance, in 29 and 30, you start off at fortissimo and a stretto, so he wants it quicker, and then an accelerando. You're already at fortissimo. He gives you a crescendo in measure 30, and then the crescendo just leads you to piano in the next bar. So normally when you're playing loud and you have a crescendo, you're expecting you're going somewhere where it's going to be even louder, and he does exactly the opposite. He does the same thing in the piano section in the next two measures, 31 and 32. You're at piano, and then he gives you a decrescendo, and the decrescendo leads into a fortissimo. I'm hearing those, and I can tell that you've memorized the dynamics along with the notes, but I would love to hear that exaggerated even more. I mean, he gives you two bars where you play loud, get faster, and then suddenly you get soft and slower, and then even slower, and then loud again. So every pair of two bars is really in contrast, and I think they could. I think the contrast could be greater in that section.
John, I will translate something. So, Татьяна, okay. Вы более-менее поняли, да? Короче, насколько мы полностью удовлетворены вашим разделом, где там тема с флажолетами, вот эта новая тема, стретто, Джон говорит, что хотелось бы как-то добиться каких-то контрастов, чтобы это было просто чем-то таким совершенно сумасшедшим, потому что количество его рекомендаций по крещендо, диминуэндо, стретто, акселерандо, ретенуто, их так много, и они такие странные. Начинается фортиссимо. Это еще от фортиссимо какое-то крещендо. Это крещендо приводит к пьяно. Здесь такие вот по два такта такие странные обороты, такие странные какие-то фактуры. Короче, вот сыграйте эту секцию и удивите нас. Как, постарайтесь играть, как будто совершенно крыша поехала.
Okay, well, what I'm hearing is some extreme, tone contrast, but I'm not hearing the dynamic contrast that I think the composer is looking for.
Джон говорит, что он слышит большое различие в тембре, но он не слышит большого различия в уровне громкости, в динамике. Thank you.
One more little detail. In the fortissimo section, he has an accelerando at the end of the second measure, and in order to prepare herself for the change in dynamic and also the change in tone that she's doing, she's actually not continuing the accelerando. She's slowing up a little bit. I would love to see it as hear it as written.
Okay, so John предлагает, что вот чтобы это accelerando продолжалось столько, сколько она продолжается. То есть вы, чтобы сыграть эту секцию пиано, вы как бы успеваете немножко замедлить то, что вы ускоряли. Вы постарайтесь играть прямо accelerando до самого 31-го такта.
Там, где начинается лента, тоже accelerando? Мне просто не видно.
Anyway, I'm really picking at little details here in the notation, and I have to say, this is the type of piece that I would avoid memorizing because I would never be capable of memorizing all everything that the composer is asking for in this. And so much of it is sort of the opposite of what we might musically tend to do, you know, shaping things and stretching it a little bit before we go into a new dynamic. The other question I had about the piece is just the tempo indications. Starting in measure 39, when it goes maestoso, I could hear that she pulled the tempo back a little bit there, which I think is what is indicated. But then we have at measure 66, another maestoso marking. So I'm not sure, is that bringing us back to the same maestoso tempo again? And then at measure 92, we have that marking again. I'm not sure how varied we want these waltz tempos to be between the different sections. The sentimental one, which was the last one beginning at 108, that was clear, and I thought that was very beautiful. The section where I thought it could get a little bit crazier probably was beginning in 76, where it's accelerando poco a poco. I think you really have to pace that and maybe start a little bit slower so there's a more extreme difference in the tempos. I guess that's what
John,
I mean.
Can I summarize quickly in Russian? Yeah. So basically, like the later comment, последнее, что он говорил, было о том, что вот это маэстоза, который, то есть вопрос такой, сколько разных темпов мы хотим, чтобы было в этом вальсе? И у него, как бы он предлагает, что может иметь смысл подумать, что каждый раз, когда отмечена маэстоза, каждый раз играть в одном и том же темпе. Это раз. А второе, что может быть имеет смысл играть, то есть самые сумасшедшие, самые странные вещи начать играть в 76-м такте, когда начинается accelerando poco-poco, и Джон предлагает начать более сдержанно, чтобы было куда accelerando, и crescendo тоже, кстати. То есть это здесь надо действительно как-то удивить. Поэтому I think she should play from 76 and give us a big surprise.
Okay.
All right. So, can you play 76-го такта и постараться начать немножко более сдержанно и как-то совсем слететь с катушек, короче. Мне кажется, что можно начать медленнее, да. Это вы как бы выкладываете, открываете карты слишком рано.
Very nice. I think the more these things can be exaggerated,
Все должно быть немного утрировано. все должно быть немножко утрировано, exaggerated, значит. То есть все нюансы нужно как бы сделать еще в некотором карикатурном варианте, чтобы было интересно. Just for everybody else who's listening, I would just like to add that Pavel Vozanchiy was a symphony composer, a symphony conductor, and he understood symphony orchestra. He didn't really understand guitar the same way that, you know, real guitarists understand. He was virtuoso, he played guitar and so on, but his guitar pieces usually have this orchestral kind of scope, you know, and it's something that difficult or almost impossible to do on the guitar. And I strongly believe that he was able to do it, but you know, the recordings that we have are very poor quality.
Portions remind me a little bit of Villa-Lobos in terms of taking a shape with the left hand and just moving it around.
That's absolutely true. Yeah.
So you know, it's guitaristic in its own way.
Yeah, but just this thinking over really long stretches. I mean, that's somewhat unusual. Yeah. All right, I think we're basically pretty much out of time, need to move on. Let's see if Stefan has... the thing is, Татьяна, вы по какому изданию играете? По нашему?
Да.
Stefan and I published this music, edited this music. So, Stefan, do you have any observations?
It was very, very beautiful played. I have nothing to say, almost. I was thinking about this. I'm not sure, but no, I don't want to say. I think it.
All right, all right. In this case, you know, thank you so much, Tatiana. Thank you. Lots of it, and now we are proceeding to our next. Next participants who are brave enough to play for such strong, stern critics. That's Dmitry and Mikhail Melnik. What are you going to play? You first need to unmute yourself.
Yes, can you hear us?
Yes.
Yes.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Nice to see you guys.
Thank you. Glad to see you.
Dima and Misha, do you have anything about original sound on your screen? Does it say turn off original sound or turn on original sound?
No, hold on.
Doesn't say? No, it should be in the upper left corner. It doesn't say anything.
Left corner.
Okay. Okay, let's just take 5 minutes doing that. It's been done so many times, I know it by heart. So right next to the microphone, there is a little arrow up. Стрелочка. Идите туда. Это будет длинный лист всего, и в конце будет audio settings. Mm. И вы туда идете, and then what? Okay. And it's kind of towards the bottom of it. Okay. So there's speaker, microphone, suppress background noise. You can put it on low. And then there is music and show in meeting option, turn on original sound from microphone. This needs to be clicked.
Show in meeting options enabled. Okay.
Clicked, right? Okay, now you close this menu. And now you, in the upper left corner, you see something. So what do you see? Does it say turn off original sound or turn on original sound?
Turn off.
You have to scroll up there for it to come
up. It says turn off?
Turn on. On.
Okay, so you should push it. And it should say turn off original sound. And that means that you have original sound. So basically, Zoom does everything possible to think of guitar playing as noise and your voice as the real thing. And that's why, you know, if you don't do that, then it sounds terrible. But now it will sound simply bad. All right.
is it okay now for our purpose?
Yes. Go.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So you want to introduce our piece?
You introduce. You're better.
So the piece we would love to work on with you is called Fuego by a Croatian author, composer, Tonči Huljić. And why we want that piece is because I think It has everything that a piece like Marjanja has, right? Sort of flamboyant gypsy style, but it also has at certain times very interesting classic elements where two guitars are echoing each other and playing and all that. So that's what attracted us in that piece. But right now we have been able to work on the first part of it. There are three parts. We only talk about the first one, which is relatively straightforward melodically, but there are very challenging piece parts for us rhythmically. Oleg Vitalich, you know what I'm talking about, these challenging Balkan beats, and they are truly challenging for us. So anything to add from your side?
No, that covers it.
Okay. So can we start and play it for you?
Please.
Hold on. So if we are off beat a little bit, that's not by purpose, it's by our ability.
Okay.
There will be much more, I promise. At some point, there will be second and third part.
Right. I thought rhythmically, I mean, the place where it's the most difficult is in, well, do we have measure numbers here? Yes. In measure 5 and 6, where suddenly you start getting the dotted eights instead.
Yes.
I would love to hear the second guitar part alone from measures 5 through 7.
Okay.
Okay, you play the rhythm correctly in measure 5, but then you pause a little bit before you go into measure 6. And that's where you got off. It should just be da 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 ba da 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 ba da 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 da. It's like a pop, you know, like a Bo Diddley beat. It's a rhythm that's used in 1950s rock music quite a bit. Da 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 ba da 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 da. But don't pause after. Try it again without the pause.
Got it. Let me try. So.
That was pretty good. There was a slight pause before measure 7, but in between 5 and 6, that was perfect. If you play it like that, it'll be easier for him to line up. Let me hear the top voice on those same three measures. Okay, so you just have the same rhythm with him just that one time. And the reason you were able to get away with that pause is, of course, because he doesn't do anything. The first guitar doesn't do anything on the downbeat of the next measure. But I would leave that out, because if he's, you've got the metronome going too, and so that it'll make things line up a little bit better. Can you just do the first seven measures?
You need to. You good? You got it? Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 4. It was me. Sorry, John.
Can Try that again.
That's tough. I think I went too early on the fourth measure, right?
I might have been a bit too late.
Yes.
Too late, too early. Got it. 1, 2, 3.
That was very, very good. The only slight hesitation was, again, before the downbeat of measure seven. Just keep that da, 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 ba, da, 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 da. Just keep that going.
Try it, these two measures, six and seven, May. Do a couple of times for you.
Sure.
Can I just make a suggestion about the arrangement? I mean, since I remember how we made it. John, what do you think? Like the first two bars, I mean, since we're basically in free fall here and just freely arranging, do you think it's kind of muddles the picture that this first guitar is sort of at times slower than, in those octaves, lower than the second guitar? Maybe just the first two bars could be lifted up an octave in the first guitar. I mean, then it will be inconsequential, but it doesn't matter.
That might make things a little bit clearer, yeah.
Dima, you're playing the first guitar, right?
Misha,
can you play it an octave up, the first two? Bars. Yeah, from there. Just two bars, an octave up, and then go back to where you play.
So let me transpose it for you.
Yeah, exactly. And I think the interesting rhythm, I mean, for John it's something totally obvious. For me, it's something out of my comfort zone. So, the interesting rhythm sounds particularly interesting if the first two bars you actually play completely, you know, obviously, right. Putting the, you know, the stresses. Ta-ta-ra, pum-ta-ta-ra, pum-ta-ta-ra, like where they belong. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, you ready to play your first two? You see, you always play like this, Paul.
Yeah. I'm ready.
And go back down, yeah.
You're pausing in between each measure as well. I think you've gotten used to doing that. But just da 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 pa da 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 pa da da. Just keep that click going. I was tapping my finger the last time you played it together, and it was perfect up until measure seven. Just do the first seven measures again with the octaves up an octave.
1, 2, 3.
It got off a little bit, but that's, yeah, I think that's a better idea. And I think you'll get more used to that rhythm where you don't, it looks so much worse on the page than it actually is when you hear it. It's very nice. Rhythmically, I didn't think there was any other issues because there's no other syncopation like that goes on in the rest of the piece. So
Can we try the last two measures one more time?
Six sure.
Just to get it. If that's
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so I start.
One, well, let's two. Go, let's go from the start.
From the start?
Yeah.
Is it okay if we go from the start again?
Yeah, of course. Yep.
One, two, three, four.
Very close. Very close.
Thank you.
Okay.
No hesitation. After G note in both cases, in measures five and in measures six.
Oleg, you want to take over after the intro? I hear the rest of it again just to hear it a second time.
Yeah, yeah.
But
I mean, I just like this kind of Misha driving into seventh measure. I don't think it ever worked completely convincingly. Ta-ra-da-da-ra-da-ra-dam.
He needs to ignore the rhythm of the second guitar part,
right,
and just keep the pulse going.
Yeah. Let's try to work on that, you know, even though it's continuation of the same idea. So basically, what's your original tempo? How do you start your first bar? Pum pa 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 pum pa pa, something like that. One, two, three, four. So Misha, can you play bar six without Dima and just not thinking about this rhythm underneath, but just boom, 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 ta da 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 da, boom. Mm. Well, yeah, just okay. Let's do it slower. One, two, three, something like that. But I cannot count for you, so you know. How about Dima? You count, and Misha plays.
Here's an idea. Let's have the second guitar part play just those first three dotted rhythms, and then hear the upper part. So it'll be da 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 pa da 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 pa da pa da pa da pa.
Well, that's an interesting idea.
One,
but
two, three, four.
You're too slow on that third one. Da 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 pa da pa da pa da pa.
I think, I mean, John, correct me if I'm wrong. I think Misha started in time, but just kind of slowed down in the next beat.
Yeah. One more time, and if you're slurring any of those 16th notes, make sure that they're still very even. Da 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 pa ta pa ta pa ta pa.
Ready.
Let's try it with the entire part.
I suggest that you still do it with, you know, with some kind of metronome, human or not, just the upper part alone, because
stay honest.
Yeah, can you just do can Misha just play this ta 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 tam like really evenly, because I know you can. No, I mean you're playing ta ra da ta ra ta ra ra, and what we need is ta ra ta ta ra ta ra. So there is a very nice romantic kind of rubato there, but we need something completely brutal. Ta ra da ta da ta da tam.
So feel the third beat, even though you're not playing on it. One, two, three, e and a, four, e and a. One, two, three, e and a, four, e and a. I think we need to take out the slur because that's what's causing the triplet. Let's just do it all with the right hand. Ba ta ba ta ba ta ba ba ta ba ta ba ta ba. One e and a, two e and a, three e and a, four e and a.
Okay.
Don't slow down on it though. Ba da 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 da. All the 16ths have to be the same.
Okay, it's possible. So now you, I think you can even, you know, just count and don't listen to the second guitar or listen to it. But I mean, just try not to let it confuse you. So try it from the beginning. Boom, 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 ta 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 ta, pam.
Давайте я сделаю бум. Бум. Окей. Без бум. Окей.
It's still a little on the gentle side. I mean, it should be more sort of aggressive, aggressively rhythmical. Uh-huh. That's good. Now with Dima.
From the beginning of the.
Just from the beginning of this bar, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're waiting too long, no?
Yes.
Me, right? Okay. One, two. Three, four.
I think you're starting too late.
Da 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 pa ta pa ta pa ta pa. It might be a good idea for Misha to try playing those dotted quarter, those dotted eighth notes of the second part, and then jumping to the upper part. Da da, or playing even just open strings, just to get used to how the rhythm leads into it. Da 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 pa ta pa ta pa ta pa.
Try.
So.
Don't slow down on the group of four 16ths. Da 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 pa ta pa ta pa ta pa. Try that alone again. That was very close. Yeah, yeah. You're going ba da 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 da. You're stretching those last four 16ths, and with the rhythm that he has to play underneath it, it'll be really difficult to get that together.
Yeah. So basically, I mean, like, if it's something in your brain regarding, you know, like where the fingers should go, that needs practice, and we can only kind of provide know-how about how those rhythms are supposed to. Okay, well, basically, let's assume that Misha will have a chance to play with the metronome, just this bar. Da 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 da. One, two, three. Da 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 da. Just if you completely, you know, independently of the second guitar, if you completely can just play it in your sleep without any slowing down, all the fingers where they need to be, then there's really no problem. Let's go on a little bit. First of all, second guitar. I mean, I'm just wondering I look at it as a completely new piece, as if I had nothing to do with it, but so is it our accompaniment?
For now, yes.
So how do you play? Oh, so you're basically killing like it's the Vadik's way. Killing.
Yes, yes. I thought of this way, but which will be in some respect easy.
Yeah, but there's.
But I thought that maybe it gives me a little bit more control over the.
The basses, yeah, you don't want them to ring. That makes sense. Okay, can we hear just from bar 8? Can hear just Misha's part alone? Yeah, it sounds pretty good. I mean, like everything here. I mean, of course, I recognize our sort of sihra-like, you know, playing harp-like and so on. And I mean, it's very good and tender music. You know, in this sort of a little bit more brutal music, it's challenging. But I think we still should stick to it somehow. Just try to be very rhythmical and you know, very concrete. So let's go from the beginning of that, which is measure 8. Yes, all of us. Yeah.
Okay. So there will be four.
Okay, well, you know, since we cannot really be anything but classical guitar duo, I'm just wondering if we can make this classical effect in on measure. So now it's difficult for me to see now. Measure.
It's very small. The
yeah, measure. 11, 12. Is it 13? 14. Bar 14. When you it sort of feels like it wants some kind of dynamic, like crescendo, like which is easier to do in the bottom part, and the you know, it can only be done in the upper part if you start considerably softer at the beginning. But don't do anything with the tempo. Just kind of try to make a crescendo. You know. It doesn't have
to... Is the slurring being done as written, where it's two and two?
That I don't know. How do you slur it, Misha?
I'm playing like this. I'm playing apoyando, but I probably should play tirando.
Okay. That sounds good. So yeah, yeah. Try to make some kind of event out of it. Otherwise, we sort of miss the opportunity. Uh-huh. Can you start again from the same place?
Okay.
Measure eight.
Hold on. Ready? Four. One, two, three.
I think it's pretty good, John.
Very nice.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for what this piece is, I mean, basically you cannot go too sentimental here. So you just need to bring the virtuosity level even higher and, you know, make the rhythms very concrete and precise, and we're in business.
Thank you. I think we had a question. So we talked about crescendoing the first trill,
yeah,
which is 14, right?
Mm-hmm.
So obviously the same applies to the second one as well, which goes in measure 22, correct? We also start very soft, and then Misha goes high and high, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And then also I had a question, which is logical. If 14, for example, is higher, and then we build it and build it and build it, then of course 16 is where we again drop to lower, correct? After his trill.
I think so. I mean, there is no absolute truth here. So there are two possibilities, as far as I can tell. But if you look at the bottom part, it goes tom tom pom 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 pom. I mean, you can make a bubble that sort of the peak of the crescendo is on the downbeat of 15. And then you go down. That's one possibility. And the other, I think, which is more pop, sounding to my classical ears, if you go crescendo all the way through, and then have a suddenly lyrical moment.
So again, lyrical.
Yeah.
But even lyrical should be very much on time. Just, I mean, in this piece, you should not be romantic at all. I think it's just the wrong genre for that. You just, like, it should be very concrete, you know. 16th notes are exactly what they're written. I mean, no, not even a swing, as far as I'm concerned.
Fuego, fire, yes?
Fire.
Fire, correct, yeah. And for that, we had it, we are challenged still with the melodic part of end of measure 25 and the whole 26 and to some extent 27. Mm-hmm. Can we, for a second, look at that as well?
Of course.
Let's start with 25, right?
Yeah.
One, two, three, four. So we're talking mostly struggle on the first guitar. Can you play it again without me? Just yourself?
So from 25.
Yeah.
I think I would start that chromatic, descending line in 27. Start that loud and do a decrescendo with it. Yeah, da 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 da. Yeah, it just kind of disappears.
Yeah, and I would also probably have some kind of idiomatic, on the top. You know, not something that requires time, some quick way to finish it.
Arpeggio, some,
yeah, something like that.
Okay.
And the last chord is volume wise higher than the last.
I mean, you get a little decrescendo. Yeah, da.
Jam. Okay. So it's. Like this. Okay. Got it. Mm-hmm. Ready? Let's do it. 25. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Perfect. All right. Well, so basically, I mean, most of this piece conceptually is very mature, in my humble opinion. And only the very beginning had some conceptual kind of, how should I put them, hurdles. I mean, like things where you need to kind of reevaluate what you're doing, but you're extremely close, in, I think. So.
But you were right. It is very challenging rhythmically. It is.
Well, for us who never listened to the rock and roll of the 50s, it's hard, you know. For John, it's like nothing. For Stefan, it's probably also nothing. Are you kind of a rock and roll guy, Stefan? All right, well, I suggest that we end at this moment because there is a concert coming in an hour and 9 minutes. Everybody knows about it. Please come and, I mean, there will be an interesting singer who is physically in Iowa City. There is my mother playing, Natalia Timofeeva, at the very end of the concert, and lots of Timur Fischel, who is, originally from Kyiv but living in Tallinn, and also quite a bit of Ivan Zhuk, who basically shared with me his morning exercises. He sits in the staircase of his house and just plays whatever comes to his mind. So I just this phone video I used for this concert. So please all come. Thank you for everybody. Thank you for participants. Thank you, Tatiana. Thank you. Thank you, Dima and Misha. Thank you, Wojciech. Great thanks to Wojciech. I mean, this is a great idea that we have Polish participants and that I really, really wanted to get there. And I really hope that one day you will come to Yargos in person, unless you are like Morten Falk, who decided that he's no longer flying and he is going on a tour. He does it by bicycle. So you cannot bicycle to Iowa City. It just takes too long. And the ice is melting the North Pole and all that. So, you know, everybody, see you, so to speak, in a little more than an hour. Thank you.